Mini chapter 107, Victory and Disaster, Second Doorway of No Return. Amber parks halfway down Factory Place. He licks again at the scratches on the backs of his hands from Kelly's cursor in the server farm and glances in the rearview mirror at the blood-flecked pin cuts across his face. He pulls a pair of leather gloves on, gets out of the car and locks the doors. The last time he visited here was in the company of a severed pig's head. This time he's alone. Up in the house on Electra Drive, Jaymi closes his eyes. He pictures Amber accessing the interior of the Factory Place building, somehow, through a combination of uncanny strength, unbeatable willpower, cunning, and patience. The details of how those four elements come together on this occasion are a matter of straightforward execution, of little theoretical interest. They come together. Jaymi leaves his eyes closed, supporting his head in his hands, while his eyes burn on behind his eyelids. How heavy his head feels, charged up by the unique, irreversible journey he has taken to get to this moment, and weighted with this power he's accreted around him like layers of a magnetic field. He pictures Amber accessing Kelly's loft with that giant blonde spider's metal strength, unpreventable by her. He pictures Amber stalking through her hallway. He pictures him turning into her living room, then seeing her there in front of him on the sofa. He pictures her looking up, seeing Amber, and rising to her feet in terror. As she recognizes him, her terror grows. She knows what he's empowered with. Amber springs forward at Kelly. He pins her down on the sofa, immobilizes her, and claps a hand over her screaming mouth, beauty caught by the beast. How his darkness has grown beneath that blonde hair and behind his eyes. Seeing into those eyes, while he holds her down here at arm's length, she is electrified by the extent to which the darkness in them has a forbidden quality within it, of an existential flavour, rich with sociopathy, body horror, madness. For Amber, by contrast, her eyes are hard and empty, with the things this whole loft is flavoured by, her entrapment in the world of the trivia score, wacky or boring newsfeed, and its four siblings. The brainless questions that consequently fill her mind, her cosy infantile laughter, her contentment to spend her life creating Ain't They Freaky, and her unthinking pleasure in spreading this game around the world. You're a goner now, he murmurs, almost soothing in his manner. You know that, yes? You've bitten off more than you can chew. You know you're going to lose and bleed. Let's wait and see what'll happen in a minute's time, shall we? She flails. He contains this. He tilts his head, solicitous. Oh, Kelly, if only you'd approach things as Herb and Ashley have approached them, going over to Jamie's side. Oh, but yes, they have done that. Then how many times fewer problems would have been caused? Ah, well, time to slide lazily away now. Next, watch me kill you, including all that stuff inside your head. Yes. Here it comes, Kelly, so enjoy the rush. Keeping one big hand over her mouth to stop her shouting, he throttles her with the other one, easy and calm. She chokes. She cannot breathe. The same sort of white specks and flecks swim through her vision, as Shigim always sees whenever he faints. For Kelly, however, since actual asphyxiation is upon her, these swimming shreds go on to proliferate and thicken and harden, as in speeded-up aerial footage of the spreading of shantytown slum roofs up a peninsula on the edge of a city. As death stoops down towards her, she sees herself as a princess being executed in a Middle Eastern country. As a last indulgence, she is allowed to be carried along in a royal sedan chair, which turns out to be the mode of execution itself. The chair is lifted to the level of a high balcony, where it becomes airtight and fills up with red wine, through which she smokes as if sitting in her own bong, until she is quite submerged, beginning only at the last moment to flounder. Kelly slumps, lifeless. Amber feels her neck for a pulse and verifies there's none. Then he looks calmly upwards at an angle through the air of the loft, straight into the eyes of Jaymi Peak. And with that mild smile of humorous intelligence playing beneath his features, Amber salutes his creator. Jaymi wrenches his attention out of Amber. He launches himself up from his desk chair as if fleeing that mild smile and salute. He crosses the room to the sofa and flops down onto it, breathing hard. Kelly is dead. So be it. Lying there with his eyes closed, he realizes how exhausted he is. So extraordinary have the last couple of days been, he has lost track of when he last slept. He must get back to Amber in a minute, but just for now, just for a moment, he needs to rest his mind. And, of course, he falls asleep. So precipitously does he fall asleep, he is unaware of the dramatic events that next unfold in the Factory Place loft. He almost latches onto those events while falling past them into unconsciousness, but they sound so much like a distant puppet show occurring beyond the thickness of several apartment walls that his attention cannot quite grab onto them. The first event Jaymi misses is a loud buzz at the front door of Kelly's loft. Amber lets go of her, moves on cat feet to the front door, and peers through the spy hole. Two cops are in the corridor outside. Their stance suggests they are poised to draw their weapons if necessary. Amber freezes as it clicks into place in his head. At some moment after Kelly saw him, she must have managed to trigger an emergency call to the police using some hidden device that was within her reach on the sofa. He remains dead quiet, in calculated thought, until he knocks his shoe into something on the floor of the dim hallway in a rare show of clumsiness, causing a thump and a clatter as something falls over. He swoops his face back to the spy hole, and sure enough, the cops have drawn their weapons and are hollering for him to open the door. He makes no reply, stepping smartly back up the hall to the sitting room. The cops open fire. The door lock smashes. They kick the door in and barrel down the hall, their weapons trained on him. Retreating into the middle of the room, he glances at the dead Kelly and raises both his arms in surrender. He offers the cops no resistance when they grab him, handcuff him, escort him downstairs, and bundle him into a police car outside on Factory Place.